Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the third meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee 2023. I'm sorry for the slight delay. There were problems with transport this morning. Agenda item one is a decision on taking business in private. We have the consideration of whether to take items three and four in private. Item three is the consideration of the evidence we will hear today on the legislative consent memorandum on the energy bill. Item four is the consideration of our work programme. Do we agree to take these items in private? Yeah. We are agreed. So that is items three and four will be taken in private. Agenda item two is the consideration of a legislative consent memorandum on the energy bill, and I refer members to the papers for this item. The bill was introduced to the House of Lords on the 6th of July 2022 and aims to strengthen the resilience of the UK's energy systems. A legislative consent memorandum was lodged by the Scottish Government on the 28th of September, which recommends Parliament only consents to some clauses making provisions in the devolved areas and withholds consent for others. Today we'll hear from Michael Matheson, the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero Energy and Transport, to discuss in more detail the Scottish Government's position on the bill. I'd like to welcome you, Cabinet Secretary, 2 weeks running to the committee. So welcome this morning. I'd like to welcome Raggie Lowe, who's the Deputy Director of Onshore Electricity Policy and Strategic Coordination for the Scottish Government, and Dawn Sungu, who's the Strategic Coordination Team Leader for the Scottish Government. We've got about an hour for this item, but there is some flexibility there. Cabinet Secretary, I think you want to make a brief opening statement, so I'm happy for you to go ahead.
Good morning. Yes, Convener, if you can bear with me, it's slightly longer than normal to go through the key areas that I want to set out to the committee for our position this matter. The Energy Bill, as you rightly say, was introduced to the House of Lords on the 6th of July 2022. It was set out at that time by Greg Hands. Scottish ministers at that time were asked to give confirmation of their consent in principle to begin the legislative consent process in the Scottish Parliament through the LCM, which was then introduced to the Scottish Parliament on the 28th of September. Having carefully reviewed the bill, the Scottish Government recommends Parliament give consent to some but not all of the clauses contained within the bill. A number of the clauses impact in devolved areas, and further clarification or amendments are needed from the UK Government to ensure that the bill respects the long-established powers of Scottish ministers and the Scottish Parliament to act in relation to matters that fall within devolved competence. I'm recommending that the Scottish Parliament provide consent to certain clauses relating to amendments to the Nuclear Installations Act 1956, market reform and consumer protection, the regulation of heat networks and the civil nuclear sector. We have provided details on each of these clauses in the LCM. I'm recommending that the Scottish Parliament withhold consent to a number of clauses. These are set out within the LCM, and the Scottish Government is in discussions with the UK Government about further amendments or clarification. These clauses are Part 1, the licensing of carbon dioxide transport and storage, where an amendment is being requested requiring Ofgem and the Secretary of State to consider Scottish statutory emissions targets in the exercise of functions related to Part 1. Part 2, carbon dioxide capture, storage, etc., and hydrogen production, where an amendment is being requested to require the Secretary of State to obtain consent from Scottish ministers if regulations contain provisions that would be within devolved competence. Part 3, low carbon heat systems, clauses 98 to 107, where the Scottish Government has requested changes to include provision for Scottish ministers to give consent to secondary regulations where devolved competence is touched upon. Some clauses within Part 7 of the Heat Networks Chapter 1, as the clauses propose that the Secretary of State needs only to consult Scottish ministers on devolved matters rather than to seek their consent. Schedule 15, Part 5, Paragraph 33, where an amendment has been requested to remove any reference to Scotland, as the relevant powers do not apply here. Part 11, oil and gas environmental protection clauses at 225, due to the fact that in the territorial seas adjacent to Scotland, there is a mixed picture on legislative competence depending on the activity in question. Clause 226, subclause 2, 3 and 4, and clause 227, as these appear to modify and alter devolved competence and would appear to erode extant powers held by the Scottish Parliament and ministers. And part 13, the general clause at 238, as it would affect the devolved and exclusively devolved functions of the Scottish Parliament and ministers. The detailed reasons for these recommendations being recommending withholding consent. These clauses are set out in the LCM, and at the request of the committee, I also provided further information in my letter of the 16th of January 2023. The UK Government introduced amendments to the House of Lords on Monday, the 9th of January, relating to processes for habitats, regulations, assessments for offshore wind projects. These clauses are part of the UK Government's Offshore Wind Environmental Improvement Package and have been the subject of significant engagement between the UK and Scottish ministers and officials. We have real and significant concerns that these clauses, as currently drafted, could pose a risk to realising Scotland's offshore wind ambitions, and will continue to engage closely with the UK Government to ensure these concerns are addressed. It is the Scottish Government's intention to submit a supplementary LCM relating to both the Offshore Wind Environmental Improvement Package, and if necessary, for any clauses where relevant amendments have been made to the Energy Bill during its parliamentary passage. In addition, I would also like to thank the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee for their further scrutiny of clauses of Clause 172. As a result, the Scottish Government now recommends withholding consent to Clause 172. As I advise the committee by letter, this recommendation will be included in a future supplementary LCM. And of course, I'm happy to respond to any questions the committee may have.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Before we go into questions from members, I just have a quick question on the ongoing discussions, which you have said that I believe the Scottish Government is expecting some response by the end of the month. Are you expecting that there will be a satisfactory outcome and there may be a subsequent LCM, or what are your views on that? Just a general indication of how it's going, I guess, Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we had an indication that we would get a response to our initial concerns that I highlighted in August last year. So I'm still waiting for a response to my letter from August last year on this matter.
Lots happened since then.
So since then, officials have continued to be engaged with officials within the UK government. We had an indication last week that we would receive a response ahead of this committee appearance. That hasn't materialised. We've now been advised that we are likely to get a response next week. From the UK Government on the clauses that we've highlighted back in August. So we're continuing to have engagement with them, but we are still waiting for formal feedback directly from them on the issues of concern that we raised back in August.
Okay, thank you. So there is still ongoing discussions. The first question then comes from Mark Ruskell. Mark.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Morning to you all. Can I start with a broader question, then perhaps we can then get into the specifics around certain amendments that you're looking to change. The Energy Strategy Just Transition Plan, does this align with the Energy Bill? Will the Energy Bill help to deliver the government's plan, or are there particular areas of divergence?
So potentially, the areas that I mentioned that we are still in discussions around with regards to the offshore wind improvement arrangements, if we aren't able to get the amendments that we require to be made to the legislation, it could have a negative impact on the rollout of some offshore wind installations for a variety of reasons. So it could create confusion around the regulatory process, and it could also create some duplication in the system. So there is a risk that it could actually have an adverse impact on offshore wind developments and the consenting process associated with that. However, if we can get the necessary amendments that we've been highlighting for some months now, then it has the potential to help to improve the process and to potentially speed up the process. So the approach I've been trying to take with the UK Government on this matter is that I think we've got a shared endeavour in looking to take forward our offshore wind development programme in an efficient, effective way in order to meet our climate change targets. The amendments that we've proposed could help to do that and to achieve that more quickly, and that's why we've been pursuing this issue with the UK Government. So at this stage, it has the potential to improve it, but if it doesn't, if we don't get the amendments we're looking for, it could have a negative impact on offshore wind projects in Scotland.
Okay. I know colleagues are going to come back on that specific point later on, but can I turn to an amendment which you've requested around the need for Ofgem and Secretary of State to consider Scottish emissions targets. What's the concern, the underlying concern here?
Which particular clause are you referring to?
So I think you're recommending withholding consent from Part 1 until it's amended so that both Ofgem and Secretary of State can consider Scottish emissions reductions targets.
Yeah, so the purpose behind that is that in creating a regulatory authority through Ofgem, it's important that the regulatory process that they put in place in supporting the rollout of heat networks is reflective of the fact that we have different statutory targets from the UK in meeting our net zero targets, so by 2030 and 2045. And it was to ensure that as the regulatory authority that Ofgem have an obligation to make sure that they are aligning their regulations to reflect the statutory targets we have here in Scotland. So that's the primary reason behind that. The danger is that, as a regulator, that they align purely to the UK approach, which would again put us at a difficulty in meeting our statutory targets for 2030 and 2045.
Okay. Are there any other areas in relation to Part 1 then that relate to that requirement to have cognizance of Scottish targets? I mean, I think you mentioned CCS in your opening.
Yeah. So the other part in there is in relation to is Part 1, which is a licensing of carbon dioxide transport and storage. I think the issue here is that the regulatory powers, which have been taken by the Secretary of State provisions within this section, are very broad, could impact on areas which are of devolved competence when they have been exercised. It's difficult to tell that at this present moment because of the broad nature of the powers which have been taken in this area, which is why we are looking for an amendment that would require Scottish ministers to give consent to any areas which would have an impact on devolved competence if there was a desire to make amendments in these areas. So that's why we've flagged up. It's a very broad power and it has the potential to impact in devolved powers. And the simple amendment we're looking for is to recognise that if it is going to impact in devolved powers, that there should be, it requires consent of Scottish ministers.
Right, okay.
Okay, thank you, Mark. Liam, I think you've got some questions you want to ask.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet
Secretary.
Good morning. Just a couple of questions today, please. First of all, throughout the bill, but particularly in Part 7 involving the heat networks, the Scottish Government is looking to change the provisions from to consult Scottish ministers to must obtain the consent of Scottish ministers. Can you help the committee understand what are the practical implications of sticking with consultation over seeking consent? And are you aware, is there a standard approach to this? Is it usual to consult, or is it usual to seek consent, or is there no standard?
So this is in relation to areas which are within devolved competence. So again, these are very broad powers which have been taken, and also the provision which is also made for within Part 7, which relates to the National Licensing Authority, which will be Ofgem, and the powers that they will be provided with, is that the reason we're seeking for that they requires consent from Scottish ministers is because it's in devolved areas. So because it's a broad area, broad powers which have been taken, and the responsibilities, the measures which are also being given to the Networks Licensing Authority, is that there is a requirement to make sure that if they are in devolved areas, that there's a consent of Scottish ministers on that matter. That would be the normal process I would expect to happen, and I see no harm in being able to put that in face of the bill.
Thanks for that. I understand the point being made. If, however, we start from saying, well, look, this is devolved areas, therefore there's a degree of, or a significant degree of seriousness around what's been proposed. In fact, rather than limiting it to Scottish ministers, might there be an argument for saying that the Scottish Parliament should have a role in considering any such proposals?
So normally in any regulations, it depends if it's a negative or affirmative process, is that we have to come before the Scottish Parliament. And it's by having the way in which the legislation operates is that it is you have to have the consent of Scottish ministers. Scottish ministers are then accountable to the Scottish Parliament. So in the same way, the Secretary of State has the powers, but he is accountable to the UK Parliament. It doesn't require the consent necessarily of the Parliament to exercise those powers, but they are accountable to their Parliament. So it's the exact same process at Westminster it would be here in Scotland. I think the issue here is not so much about a standoff on it's a devolved area and you can't touch it. There's a couple of areas within the bill which go into devolved areas that we are content with what's been proposed in the bill for devolved areas. And in that sense, what we're doing is making sure that if there is an exercising of powers in this area through these regulations, which then impinge upon devolved areas, the requirement for consent from Scottish ministers. So that's not unusual. That, in my view, is pretty standard. And as I say, it's not just a case of because it's devolved, we want you to consult or to consent in areas that we do agree within the bill that touch on devolved areas. We've recommended consenting to that. So this is taking powers which actually can be used at a later date, that at this stage we don't know what the impact will actually be or whether they will align with what we want to do here in Scotland. So we should require our consent before they're implemented.
And that argument having been made, going right back to the convener's first question, you've been talking to the UK government about this for, 6 months now. Mm. Do you get any sense that the argument is being heard and that there is a sympathy towards that argument, or do you have any sense of how this is going to go at this stage?
So maybe break this into two parts. So there are what I would say are the easier issues and there are more complex issues. So the more complex issues relate to the habitat regulations aspect that we touched upon earlier on, where there was amendments introduced to the House of Commons on the 9th of January. So the House of Lords to the 9th of January, which we've got significant concerns about and the potential impact they could have on offshore wind developments. That's a much more complex discussion and a much more challenging discussion which we're having. Many of these issues that I've set out in the initial LCM, in my view, are broadly quite straightforward issues. It's about moving from consulting to consent, and it is about making sure that our statutory targets are taken into account when Ofgem as a regulator is taking forward any regulatory functions that it has. So it's largely, in my view, pretty straightforward areas. The much more complex areas around the habitat regulations issues, and that's still quite a detailed discussion. If you're asking me to characterise as the process being quite straightforward, to be frank, no, it hasn't been. It's been really quite challenging. It's been quite challenging even in what I think are the straightforward areas. There are reasons for that, and you'll be aware of the reasons during the autumn because of the changes we had at ministerial level. So the fact that we still have an outstanding letter from August that's not been responded to, I think, is a reflection of the issues at the UK government side. But I hope now we have ministers in place, we should be able to get those issues progressed. But I still think there's a long way to go on the habitat regulations issues, which need to be addressed.
Very grateful. Convener.
Thank you, Liam. The next questions come from Jackie Dunbar. Jackie.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. The Scottish Government has recommended that consent be withheld from Schedule 15. As while this does not extend to Scotland, there is a definition of road contained in Part 5, Paragraph 33, which would apply to Scotland. Can I ask what your views are on the practical concerns about this schedule as it's currently drafted?
So the issue in this area is that we already have provision in our part of legislation to deal with issues around roadworks, etc., of this nature, and we have a statutory process as well for carrying that process through. So the provision that's been created within this particular part of the Energy Bill is not required here in Scotland, and it runs the danger of creating uncertainty for applicants as to how they would obtain certain
provisions because there would be competing bits of legislation. So it's, and in our view, it would go against the better regulation agenda, which we're all meant to be operating to as well, and which is why we've requested that Scotland be removed from that particular provision.
Okay, so it's just going to cause confusion?
It's just going to cause confusion for competing bits of legislation. We've already got legislative provision. It's worth keeping in mind is that our heat networks bill, it came along after the UK legislation. One of the things that we were able to do during the course of developing that legislation was to learn from some of the challenges that they've had in England with that legislation. I didn't take that legislation forward, but I know that was one of the key issues that we considered at the time. And that's why there are provisions that are within our own legislation that we don't require because we've already made provision for them, which I think this section, I may be wrong, but I suspect this section are trying to correct some of the issues I've had with their own heat networks legislation.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. I think Monica Lennon, you're up next, Monica.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Morning. I wanted to ask about the offshore wind environmental improvement package. It's been mentioned a couple of times already. Is the Scottish Government content with the actions being planned by the UK Government to reduce the consent periods for offshore wind projects that are being adopted as part of the offshore wind environmental improvement package?
So we continue to have major concerns about the amendments that have been laid so far. Those amendments were only laid on the 9th of January, and we are still going through their potential implications. There are some areas which will that could have a positive impact, but as they are in a limited way. However, as it stands at the present moment, there is still the significant risk that they could have a negative impact in slowing down the process. So with different competing consenting processes, both at a Scottish Government level and also at a UK Government level as well. There's also, for example, the clause makes provision for the Secretary of State to, with the discretion to operate a marine recovery fund, which would operate in waters out to 200 nautical miles. However, it's unclear in terms of how that would operate. So, for example, if it operates on a UK-wide basis, it means that projects which were being taken forward within waters out with Scotland could actually potentially use a marine recovery fund in Scottish waters to offset mitigations in waters out with Scotland, which could end up creating a whole range of competing demands and challenges, which would be become extremely complex and will probably cause a considerable level of anxiety, will cause a significant level of anxiety within the industry. So there's quite a significant range of concerns that we've got around, for example, the clauses don't maintain the current responsibility that Scottish ministers have for habitat regulations, assessments of offshore wind projects in the Scottish offshore wind region, which is between 12 nautical miles and 200 nautical miles. Right now, that's the responsibility of Scottish ministers. Within this legislation, that appears no longer to be the case. Therefore, it's unclear exactly how this will be taken forward, because it would appear to be that it may be seeking to dilute the current licensing and consenting responsibilities that we have within Scottish waters. The small positive aspect of it is that it has recognised that within Scottish inshore waters, which is between the coastline and 12 nautical miles, is that there is that is a responsibility of Scottish ministers. It's actually the responsibility of Scottish ministers 12 miles to 200 nautical miles as well. So how they've arrived at this idea of distinction is beyond us as well. There's also a provision within it which actually says that the Scottish Ministers have powers to adopt any new regulations for HRA in the Scottish inshore region as well would be subject to qualifying Secretary of State functions. We've got absolutely no idea what that qualifying Secretary of State functions is. What does that mean? And what are the implications of that? Is that a view that you should be able to override decisions that Scottish ministers make in areas that are devolved competence? So again, there's considerable uncertainty and some confusion around this, and it does run the risk of causing delay and complications in the consenting system in a way that it's actually we're trying to speed up and improve the system.
Thank you. And I think we all want to see clarity. I was reading a minute or a note of a meeting that took place on the 5th of December. It was the Inter-Ministerial Group for Environment, Food and Rural Affairs, and Cabinet Secretary Mary Goujon and Lorna Slater in her ministerial role were representing the Scottish Government. So the note's on the UK Government website and it's written from that perspective, but it does sound quite positive in a sense, or constructive. It said that devolved government ministers set out the importance of delivering the provision in a way that supports our shared offshore wind ambition whilst respecting devolution. And the DEFRA minister agreed that there is a need to work with devolved governments to achieve mutual objections. So some of the concerns that you've raised, Cabinet Secretary, are you aware if they were discussed in that meeting on the 5th of December?
I was, yeah. They've been discussed at many meetings. So what we haven't had is progress in addressing the issues.
So are these meetings just kind of nice chats, or are you getting into the detail in these meetings?
So the UK government have absolutely no doubt about the detail. So what we have done in relation to issues around the habitat regulations and also about offshore consenting arrangements is that there are broadly two routes that could be taken here. So one route is that some of the legislation under which consenting is taken forward is actually reserved, but it's actually executively devolved to Scottish ministers and the Scottish Parliament to consider. Is that the primary the power of that is given to the Scottish Parliament to legislate in those areas. If the UK government are not minded to do that, what they can do is they can create regulatory making powers which allow the Scottish Minister and the Scottish Parliament to consider regulations in these areas that would actually allow us to effect a change to reflect the type of adaptation we want to make in our offshore wind consenting arrangements and in our habitat regulation assessments as well. And we've set that out in detail to them as well. What we haven't had is the progress in addressing these issues.
Okay. I think people in Scotland will be wondering what this could mean for ScotWind and a potential ScotWind 2. So can you tell us what is the government's view on that, and has there been discussion with stakeholders in Scotland around the ScotWind agenda?
Yeah, well, look, it could create confusion. As I mentioned, it could create confusion. I also think it will create some instability in the system as well, because there will still be areas that are devolved that the improvement package doesn't touch upon, which will create competing demand. So it would be areas that are presently consented on by the Scottish, potentially areas that are consented on by the Scottish Government and are managed by the Scottish Government through agencies like Marine Scotland, that effectively the UK Government could say, actually, we're taking control of these matters instead. And it's a dilution of the powers that the Scottish Parliament, Scottish Ministers have in these areas of consenting. It could result in, as I say, a competing challenge between the UK government's approach to aspects of consenting and how that then impacts in other areas of devolved policy, which may be around some marine environmental issues as well. So I think it's, from the discussions we have had with the sector, there is anxiety that this is going to create confusion and competing interests, which we are trying to avoid. And there is a clear way in which to address that, and that is quite literally is to continue with the powers that we have at the present moment, but to have the scope to be able to make the regulatory changes to adapt them to reflect the changing demand which we're facing. And the other part to this, and you mentioned ScotWind, the other part to this compared to what's happening in other parts of the UK, the scale of ScotWind in terms of offshore wind development compared to another part of the UK is completely different levels. So Scotland's over nearly 28 gigawatts. It's way beyond anything that's been proposed in any other part of the UK. So the need for us to have a consenting regime that is fit for purpose, that's reflective of the different needs that we have and the different competing interests that we have to manage, from the fisher communities through to our island communities, is really important. And the danger is that we end up with a consenting system that doesn't reflect that. And that we find ourselves with less powers than we have at the present moment in consenting in these issues.
Okay. Just wrap up then by referring to Scottish Renewables. We've heard from them. They take the position that they support the Scottish Government's LCM recommending that consent is withheld for selected sections of the bill on the basis that they support growing Scotland's renewable energy sector and sustaining its position at the forefront of the global clean energy industry. Given what you've said, Cabinet Secretary, and what Scottish Renewables are saying, is it the Scottish Government's position that the bill doesn't achieve that?
No, it doesn't. In the present form, it doesn't. So there's a need for us to be able to adapt our consenting regime to deal with the scale of Scotland and actually some other offshore wind developments as well, because of the various competing needs that we now have to address within our marine environment, which is why we have to change it and we have to adapt it. However, some of the aspects that we need to change in order to do that are actually the regulations are based in legislation that is reserved to the UK government, and that we use executive powers to exercise them, to change them fundamentally in a way that will actually help to improve that process. We need to have the regulation making powers to actually do that, if not the powers over primary legislation. So that's why I've set out there are two routes that we can go down here. You can either devolve the power or you can give us the regulation making powers, which this Parliament would then be responsible for scrutinising and how we manage that process. And to date, we've not been able to actually make the progress on these issues that we'd hope we would be able to. And I can assure you there's significant engagement, not just I know within the industry, but across different ministerial portfolios, to try and find a way in which this can be properly addressed. And it goes back to your opening point about that minute that you mentioned, is that there's a shared agenda here. Mm-hmm. The danger here is that the legislations that draft at the present moment could have the opposite effect in Scotland from what was originally intended to be its purpose. And that's why we've set out how we can make sure that we deliver on the shared agenda and also a fit-for-purpose consenting process for managing projects like Scotland and some of the big offshore renewable projects that are coming along in the next couple of years.
That's helpful. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary.
Cabinet Secretary, there's some other questions on this. I'm going to come in to the Deputy Convener, Fiona.
Can you confirm, therefore, that the issue for both governments is to how do we effectively reduce the consenting period, but you also want to improve the process, but we also need to have certainty for the industry to make sure that the developments take place as planned? And is that the area then, do you think, that if you had to come back to this committee in a supplementary LCM, that's likely to be the area of concern?
Absolutely. So it's key to it. And one of the things that we need to be able to achieve here is that with the scale of some of these developments is that some of the mitigation measures that have to be implemented through the consenting process, very often mitigations are very much based upon where that development's taking place or close by. It may not be possible to achieve that, just given the scale of some of these developments. It may have to take place in another part of our marine environment or on our coastline, which is why we have set out a range of ways in which we can achieve that, which allows us to take forward developments in a timely, efficient, effective way. If we are not able to do that, then the reality is that some of the larger developments will be significantly constrained and we'll end up having to try and mitigate it in a way that just will not be pragmatic. So there is a pathway through this. What we haven't been able to do is to get agreement with the UK government making sure that pathway is very clear. And the danger now is that, as we're picking up from industry, is concern about confusion and delay in the consenting process and not being able to manage it in a way which reflects some of the specific challenges that we've got with the scale of projects here in Scotland. And we need to be in a position where we can adapt to that, because that's not reflected in what's happening in other parts of the UK, because the scale of what we're doing is of a different magnitude.
And can I now explore, and if you can help the committee understand, any potential relationship between the UK government's Levelling Up and Regeneration Bill and what might come through in relation to the Energy Bill in relation to mitigation and environmental aspects. Clearly, we perfectly understand onshore, you want to see biodiversity mitigation, you want to see peatland restoration with onshore developments. For offshore, clearly there'll be a biodiversity impact of such major developments, and we'll want to make sure that there's mitigations.
Yeah.
And clearly environmental law and environmental mitigations are devolved competencies of this Parliament. But one of our concerns when we did our report into the UK Levelling Up and Regeneration Bill, which we published at the end of December, was the new system would mean that where there was cross-border areas and sees quite clearly that can take place, that the Secretary of State for the Environment of the UK government would not have to consult with the Scottish Parliament, the Scottish government, in terms of that mitigation. And the mitigation, therefore, for environmental issues would be under the auspices of the Secretary of State for Environment,
yeah,
and could have major impacts. So, for example, if part of our mitigations, we might want to develop seaweed farms, or we might want to do something particularly with our bird population, etc., that there would be no responsibility, accountability, and indeed planning and funding control from the Scottish Government, that could actually transfer to the Secretary of State for Environment. Now, please, if I've got this wrong, please let us know, but I was concerned about the interaction between these two bills.
No, you're correct, because there is quite a significant interaction, particularly around the habitat regulation assessment,
right,
aspect of it as well. So a practical example could be, say, for example, in a marine recovery fund, if it operates at a UK level, is that you could have an offshore wind farm being developed in, say, the Celtic Seas, which is a project that's been taken off in Wales, but the actual mitigations could be applied in a fishery in Scotland. So because of the negative impact that they would have on, say, for example, a certain type of bird life, and they actually say, well, actually, if we close a certain fishery in Scottish waters, that could actually be classed as a mitigation to help to support that. The challenge that you've got with that is that then projects in Scotland that actually may need mitigations that involve closure of certain fisheries to help to support it wouldn't have access to that. But the other part to it is that the closure of that fishery would have a significant potential, I'm just using this as an example, but could have a significant economic impact on a community which the Scottish Government would be largely responsible for addressing, but we weren't responsible for making a decision on closing a particular fishery. So as a mitigation for a wind farm, offshore wind farm, taking place somewhere else in UK waters.
So, can I just clarify? It could work the other way around, though, couldn't it? So something could be developed up here which may have an environmental impact, which is then translated into another part of the United Kingdom.
Potentially.
So it can work both ways, surely?
Potentially, but the difference is that in Scotland, the scale of what's been taken forward is of a different magnitude from what's happening in the rest of the UK waters. And it's worth keeping in mind what 62% of all the UK's waters are actually in Scottish waters.
So it might be more important to have the ability to offset that across the whole of the United Kingdom rather than just in Scotland waters? No.
No, quite the opposite, because the reason being is that the vast majority of the mitigations are probably going to fall within Scottish waters or within the Scottish coastline because of the scale of what we're looking to do with offshore wind. So if you look at the scale of what's projected in waters around England, it's of a much smaller scale than what's proposed in Scottish waters. And the danger is that smaller projects in other parts of the UK start taking up mitigation measures for large-scale projects in Scottish waters. So, and it then constrains them and limits them. But even if I had the power, so one of the things we're saying is that any marine mitigation fund in Scotland should be a matter which is the responsibility of Scottish ministers to the Scottish Parliament, is that if I was to be given the powers to take mitigations in other parts of the UK, I've got no doubt very quickly people saying, actually, that's not the right thing to do because I'm not responsible for the wider impact that actually has on fishing communities, etc. That's a matter that would have to be decided upon by UK ministers.
But you could consult with them to see if it would work.
Well, to be honest with you, I wouldn't want to consult with them. I think if I'm placing a responsibility on them, I think it's my responsibility to get their consent and their agreement to it. The problem with this is that that's not what's proposed. The proposal is that it will actually be quite a centralised system based in Whitehall that will decide these things, which doesn't necessarily reflect the scale of what we're looking to take forward here in Scotland and also the impact that some of these mitigations may have on communities or certain industries. The responsibility of the impact that would have would then fall to Scottish ministers.
So if I can continue my questioning in this area, what you're suggesting is there should be consent both ways in terms of the environmental impact and mitigations as a result of the energy bill, but clearly implications for Scotland are far bigger because of the scale of the operations in Scotland to potentially. So is that what you'll be seeking in terms of changes to the energy bill? And does that require any interaction with the other bill I was referring to and that the UK government is pursuing as well, that consent would work both ways? Currently, there's only consultation with Scottish ministers.
So, I don't know, Raggy, do you want to say a wee bit more about the interaction with the other piece of legislation? Because it's part of this wider engagement we're having with the UK government around this as well. In terms of how any marine mitigation fund or recovery fund would operate, we're moving into new territory here. And there are a lot of competing demands that we have to try to address. So a combination of trying to achieve the outcome that we're trying to get in terms of offshore renewable potential, the impact that has on our marine environment, and also those who are dependent upon our marine environment, our fisher communities, our seabird life, etc., which Scotland is a major part of. It has a major role in helping to support a European level as well. And the idea with the Marine Recovery Fund is to try and help to try and take a balanced approach where we can try to mitigate against some of the impacts that large-scale offshore wind developments will have on a marine environment. The view is that for that system to operate effectively in Scotland, our view is that that's a matter which should be, as it would be at the moment, for any mitigations and consenting for offshore wind, is a matter for Scottish ministers to make decisions upon as well. If there was a view that it was to operate at a UK-based level, a UK-wide level, is that there would be a need to have a process in place where Scottish ministers were asked for consent to agree to changes that may come about in a marine recovery fund being applied in Scotland to offset the impact of a development taking place out with Scotland. And what that would have to be weighed against, it would have to be weighed against what impact does that have on potential other projects taking place in offshore in offshore Scottish waters. So, and how do you manage all of these competing demands? And if it is applied, what impact does that have on a community or an industry or bird life in Scotland? What impact will it have, and how do we balance that out against all of the other projects that will probably end up having to have mitigation measures put in place as well? So that's a challenge, and we're able to try and achieve that. So it would have to be a process that would require Scottish ministers' consents, but it would also need to be a balanced system so that we can properly assess the process. And at this stage, there's a lack of detail or understanding exactly how that would operate, and that's one of the major issues. But I don't know if Raggy wants to say a little bit about the interaction.
Secretary, we've got quite a few more questions that I'd like to get. I'd like to bring in Mark, because he's got a supplementary on this, which may prompt the answer to the next one. So, Mark.
Yeah, it might even feed into what Raggy would probably want to talk about anyway. But it's just to probe a little bit further about the changing nature of environmental assessments. So, on the Levelling Up Bill, a proposal to move to environmental objectives rather than the European standard and processes of environmental assessment and habitats regulations. I'm just wondering if that forms part of the concern here. Is there, with a shift in environmental assessment, could the answer to mitigation end up being different according to whether Secretary of State defines particular environmental objectives?
So I think the fundamental difference is that the UK government view that the habitat regulation aspects of it, I think this is correct, the habitat regulation aspect of it for energy purposes they see as being reserved, which is a change because they say it's for energy production purposes, which is a reserved matter. Our view is that no, that's not the habitat regulation aspects that are devolved are there for to deal with environmental aspects. Whether it's for energy production or anything else, these are devolved matters that we have competence over. So that's part of the discussion we've been having with the UK government, is to try and get a recognition that actually it's not about what the purpose for which some of these habitat regulations are for. It's the actual fundamental purpose of them that's important, and that is about managing our marine environment and effective marine stewardship. As well. But I don't know if you want to say a bit more, Raggy, about the process we've got around the levelling up.
So, in terms of the relationship between the two bills, as you say, some of the principal issues are the same, and the issues that we have around touching on devolved competence or similar. It's the energy bill that the UK government is using as the vehicle through which to implement or to introduce changes to the habitats regulation assessment process for offshore wind projects, and that's where our focus is in terms of this work on the energy bill. We can perhaps come back to you if there's anything around the if there are particular details around the relationship between the two bills that you'd like to explore further.
Okay, Mark, you've got the next question as well, I think.
No, I think I'm done.
You're finished, are you? Okay, I'll come back to you, Fiona, then.
Thank you. And looking forward, I suppose it's how do you establish bills and legislation that can be future-proof for changes that will happen in the future? You've already indicated there's issues potentially around heat networks. Does the UK Energy Bill, as it stands, you think, provide, you know, present a wider risk to devolved powers, or is it likely to limit future actions of Scottish ministers of the Scottish Parliament in the future, particularly in the energy area?
Effectively, our position is to maintain what we have at the present moment in terms of powers. So, and to look at trying to create mechanisms that can help us to address some of the challenges we know we're going to face when it comes to things like large-scale offshore wind developments. So, so we're looking to protect and maintain the existing devolved powers and competence that the Scottish Parliament and Scottish ministers have on the consenting regime, but also recognising going forward there are going to need to be changes in order to accommodate and manage some of the challenges around large-scale offshore wind developments, which is why we have been flagging up to the UK government. You can either devolve the primary legislation, which some of that has dealt with, if not, then create the regulation-making functions that allow Scottish ministers and the Scottish Parliament to adapt and change to some of the challenges which we're going to face in the years ahead. So my view in terms of your challenge around future-proofing is that having a regulatory process in there allows us to give that flexibility to adapt and change to some of the challenges as we go forward. The danger is that if we don't have that, is that we find ourselves in a situation where it creates confusion and difficulty and some instability in the process. And it creates a longer, more challenging process than would be necessary. And what we think could be changed in the system to make it a much more efficient system.
And you see the immediate issues around offshore. Is there anything potentially on onshore in terms of our environmental aspects in relation to the other parts, the wider aspects of the bill, whether it's hydrogen, carbon capture, etc.? Anything that you think, I suppose it's looking at environmental impacts onshore of any developments that might take place and the mitigations for that. For example, the Acorn project, Grange Biosuite, etc.
Yeah. So some of the powers that are created within here, for example, around hydrogen and carbon storage, as I was mentioning, I think, to Liam Kerr's question, is that some of them are very broad powers that have been taken by UK ministers, which, in our view, are likely to impinge on devolved areas at some point with the regulation-making functions that they are creating for themselves. Therefore, that's why we're saying is that if it is going to impact on devolved areas, then we need to make sure that there is a consenting process for agreement to that. So we're trying to, again, make sure that there's a move from consult to consent, because these are areas that we already have powers in that we would expect to be require the consent of Scottish ministers and the Scottish Parliament, and that should be reflected in the broad powers that are being created in some of these areas. On the onshore side, there's not so much in terms of onshore within this legislation as well. There are some issues around consenting in onshore. Most of that's done through planning legislation in Scotland. Yeah. As you're aware, there are some aspects around this that could be improved, which are within the Electricity Act around consenting, which we're engaging with the UK government on for. That's mainly to do with large interconnectors. But again, I'd be hopeful we'll be able to get some sort of resolution to these matters, but I don't think that's addressed within this piece of legislation. It's not within this bill itself.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Liam, I think you've got a quick question.
Yes, Convener. It follows on from the Deputy Convener's question and actually taking you back, Cabinet Secretary, to what I asked at the start. So we were talking about looking to change from merely to consult to consent, and I think what I was hearing was that would be the more usual and perhaps more appropriate way to go. And if that's right, do you have any view on how, given the number of times this comes up in this particular process, how we could identify, or how you could identify, the UK government could identify, at an earlier stage of the drafting issues such as this, in order that we don't get to this stage, it's, let's say 6 months on from when it was initially raised, such that by this stage we're arguing on the substantive, more substantive matters that you've detailed?
I think that's a good point. The most effective way to address that would be an earlier sharing of the draft of the bill in itself. We only received a draft copy of the bill the day before it was published. So it was only the day, you know, less than 24 hours before it was introduced to Parliament, we were given a copy of it. So what we have flagged up to the UK government consistently is an earlier sharing of the draft allows us to feed into that process at an earlier stage. So, and that, in my view, would be the most effective way to try to help to avoid getting into these types of situations as well. The only thing I would say in addition to that is that we were in good discussions with the UK government prior to the publication of the bill as well. But at that stage, there were discussions which were based upon no details of what exactly was going to be in the bill itself. So I think earlier, and sharing an earlier draft of it with us would be the most effective way to deal with that, Mr Kerr.
Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'm just looking around at the committee to see if anyone else has any other questions. For me, that last point was quite interesting, Cabinet Secretary, just the fact that you got the bill the day before. It would help me just to understand that and may help the committee if you could share with us the letter of the 9th of August that you sent to the UK government. I don't see it online somewhere. Maybe I've missed it, but maybe you could just send it to us afterwards so we've got an idea of the substantive questions that you raised at that stage and haven't been answered. Yeah. Cabinet Secretary, I'd like to thank you for your time and your officials' time this morning coming to the committee. And that really concludes our part of the public meeting, and so we're going to go into private session. Thank you.